Good morning and welcome to worship at the Weston United Methodist Church today, April 12, 2020, Easter Sunday morning. You'll find announcements for the upcoming week located in the bulletin which was sent out this week. We have a new Bible study starting this week called Freedom from Worry. How appropriate is that for right now? And we invite any of you to join us. If you check the beams for more information about how to get the study information and so on, the beams have been posted online if you didn't get it by email. Or you can contact me directly and I'll share some of that information with you. We'll be doing it at 7 o'clock via Zoom on Tuesday evenings for 4 weeks. This week, Church Council and Trustees both meet. And now, let's pray that we are all richly blessed by this time of worship together, and that we will return to the world whenever we do that, in whatever ways we do that, much more able to be a blessing to it. Let's prepare our hearts for worship as we listen to this morning's prelude.
Thank you.
Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Praise the Lord. And so, we run to the tomb, and we are forever surprised. Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Through our tears of sorrow and despair, we don't recognize him. Christ is risen.
He is risen. He is risen indeed.
Then he calls us by name. Christ is risen.
Christ is risen.
We run into the world announcing, we have seen the Lord. Christ is risen.
Christ is risen indeed. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Let us pray. Giver of new life, we worship you this morning with hallelujahs, banners, flowers, and song. We worship in beauty and in truth, because we have faith that Jesus Christ is raised from the dead, because we have hope that the resurrection will enter each of our lives and transform them, and because, through Christ's Spirit, we have come to love one another. Accept our worship, gracious God, and hear our prayers today. We trust you to care for all of our concerns. Amen. Let's sing the first four verses of Christ the Lord is Risen Today. Spirit-filled life. glory. Today we proclaim Christ's resurrection. The one who taught with authority, healed with compassion, and lived with your grace could not be contained by any tomb, nor can the love to which his life testifies be confined to any one group or nation or people. No bonds or boundaries restrain Christ. We strain to understand the breadth of your love, the depth of its reach, and the mystery of its power to bring new life from death. Today, let us break out of all that constrains our belief and our love, and let us share with joy the glorious message meant for all humanity that he is risen. O Lord, we pray for your church around the world this day, that it may testify to your way, your truth, and your life in all that it does in these days. Make us powerful and effective witnesses to what you have done, what you are doing, and what you have yet to do. O God, we pray for the nations of this world today. We pray for peace in Jerusalem and all the peoples who live there. We pray for all countries in conflict, both within and without. O Lord, we pray this special day for those who are separated from loved ones, for those who are homeless, for those who are unwanted or forgotten. With Christ, we remember those who are hungry, those who are naked, those who are in prison. And Lord, we pray for our families and for our neighbors and for all those whom you have placed upon our hearts this day. Hear the prayers of thanksgiving and intercession that we make for them and on account of them in our hearts and in our minds. Now let's join together in a litany of confession. Because people are suffering from the COVID-19 virus, it doesn't feel like Easter. But healthcare workers are tirelessly caring for the sick. We are seeing Easter at work.
Lord of love, keep leading us to be an Easter people.
Because people are losing their jobs and businesses, it doesn't feel like Easter. But neighbors are offering help and hope for one another. We are seeing Easter at work.
Lord of love, keep leading us to be an Easter people.
Because we are isolated and unable to offer a handshake or a hug, it doesn't feel like Easter. But we are making phone calls and finding other ways to reach out. We are seeing Easter at work.
Lord of love, keep leading us to be an Easter people.
Because people continue to struggle with poverty, oppression, and pain, it doesn't feel like Easter. But despite this pandemic, people are finding new ways to be the hands and feet of God. We are seeing Easter at work.
Lord of love, keep leading us to be an Easter people.
Because our church sanctuaries are empty, it doesn't feel like Easter. But we hold on to the hope that our day of resurrection will come, because nothing can separate us from God's love. We will see Easter at work.
Lord of love, keep leading us to be an Easter people and give us the courage to be the kind of church you want us to be.
All these things we ask of you in the name of Jesus, who taught us to pray this way. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. And now we have a very special hymn that was written just for this time by Carolyn Winfrey Gillette, called This Easter Celebration, and you'll recognize the tune as the Church's One Foundation tune. I shall not die, but I shall live and recount the deeds of the Lord. The Lord has punished me severely, but did not give me over to death. Open to me the gates of righteousness, that I may enter through them and give thanks to the Lord. This is the gate of the Lord. The righteous shall enter through it. I thank you that you have answered me and have become my salvation. The stone that the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone. This is the Lord's doing. It is marvelous in our eyes. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. And our gospel lesson today is from the Gospel of John, chapter 20, the first 18 verses. Early on the first day of the week, While it was still dark, Mary Magdalene came to the tomb and saw that the stone had been removed from the tomb. So she ran and went to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one whom Jesus loved, and said to them, "They have taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we do not know where they have laid him." Then Peter and the other disciples set out and ran toward the tomb. The two were running together, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. He bent down to look in and saw the linen wrappings lying there, but he did not go in. Then Simon Peter came, following him, and went into the tomb. He saw the linen wrappings lying there, and the cloth that had been on Jesus' head not lying with the linen wrappings, but rolled up in a place by itself. Then the other disciple, who reached the tomb first, also went in, and he saw and believed. For as yet they did not understand the scripture that he must rise from the dead. Then the disciples returned to their homes. But Mary stood weeping outside the tomb. As she went, she bent over to look into the tomb, and she saw two angels in white sitting where the body of Jesus had been lying, one at the head and the other at the feet. They said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping?" She said to them, "They have taken away my Lord, and I do not know where they have laid him." When she had said this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing there, but she did not know that it was Jesus. Jesus said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping? Whom are you looking for?" Supposing him to be the gardener, she said to him, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have laid him, and I will take him away." Jesus said to her, "Mary." She turned and said to him in Hebrew, "Rabboni," which means teacher. Jesus said to her, "Do not hold on to me, because I have not yet ascended to the Father. But go to my brothers and say to them, I am ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God." Mary Magdalene went and announced to the disciples, "I have seen the Lord." And she told them that he had said these things to her. Blessings of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
We will sing the first two verses of Thine Be the Glory. God, as you opened the tomb and raised Jesus to new life. So open our hearts and minds by the power of your Holy Spirit, that as your word is proclaimed, we may hear with joy deep in our hearts what you say to us today. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. So, my friends, did you hear what was just read? The account of Jesus' resurrection? Can you imagine the reaction of those closest to Jesus? Consider for a moment the 24th chapter of Luke's Gospel, when Mary Magdalene and Joanna and the other women told Jesus' disciples what had happened to them at the empty tomb. It says in verse 11 that it seemed to them an idle tale, and they did not believe them. Isn't that a fascinating verse to include in the account of the resurrection? Here we are, trying to celebrate the greatest event in the history of the world. Here we are, ready to rehear the greatest story ever told, that death has been defeated, that sin holds no power to destroy us, that a kingdom awaits us, that there can be new life now. Here we are, and what do we hear? We hear that those closest to Jesus during the 3 years of his ministry, those who heard him preach on the hillside and beside water, those who had shared in miracles, those who had broken bread with him as only friends can in the intimacy of the upper room, those who had heard him teach with patience about the kingdom of God, now we hear that when they heard the amazing story of the empty tomb, they thought it was nonsense. Doesn't that surprise you a little bit? It does me. The disciples were true followers of Jesus. They were the eyewitnesses to Jesus' ministry. If they had not shared what they saw and heard, we wouldn't have today the story of Jesus to tell. And here they are, these people of faith, those whom Jesus told about his new kingdom that he was establishing, those whom Jesus tried to tell about what would happen after 3 days, and they thought it was an idle tale. Nonsense. But you know what? They were right. This story the woman told them is nonsense. Who ever heard of someone regaining life after being declared dead for 3 days? That's outrageous. The brain cells would have died. The body would already be decomposing. It's nonsense to think that someone who went through the agony of crucifixion and died, breathing his last breath, could suddenly get up and walk out of a dark, damp tomb. And what about that huge stone that was rolled away from the tomb's entrance? Explain that. This whole resurrection story is so much nonsense. It defies medical explanation. It goes against rational thinking. It just is not possible. But it happened. Dear friends in Christ, it happened. It is nonsense, but it happened. I believe one of the biggest problems with Christianity is that people want to take the nonsense out of it. I've heard radio preachers and television evangelists and all manner of Christians try to say that Christianity makes sense, that it's the easiest, most natural thing in the world to believe in Christ. I've heard sermons that almost convinced me that being a follower of Jesus is simple, that the stories of miracles and healings and the accounts of Jesus' life, some of them awesome and amazing, are easy to accept. I've heard it said that it's logical to believe in someone who walked this earth almost 2,000 years ago, who lived in an obscure corner of creation, someone who performed miracles, who fed 5,000 people with a few loaves and fish, who raised a friend from death, who forgave a scorned woman at a well for sins. You tell me. Is it logical to believe in something that happened so long ago, so far away, something that defies medical and scientific and rational explanation? I don't know about you, but I'm afraid I could easily be in the camp with the disciples. It is nonsense. To believe any of this would be to accept what is not possible. Believing in an event, in a story that is so radical, would have to change one's perception of life. If we believe the women's story, who ran from the tomb that first Easter morning, then we're stuck with believing something so new, so different, so radical, that our lives would have to change to be new. Our lives would have to change to be new, to be different, to be radical as a result of such a belief. No matter what anybody says, it is not logical, it's not rational, it doesn't make any sense to believe in Jesus the Christ. It is nonsense, and yet it is real. And according to the Gospel of John, the very earliest response to the event of the resurrection was not praise, not ecstatic dancing, not even stark terror or paralyzed fear, not unbridled joy or exultant song, but running. Yes, running. In the early morning hours of the first day of the week, as it began to crack across human consciousness that something utterly unexpected and world-shifting had occurred out there in the Garden Cemetery, the first people who experienced this event reacted by running, running all over the place. First, there's Mary Magdalene. In the quiet darkness just before dawn, she makes her way to the burial place of Jesus. She is the first to encounter the great surprise of the empty tomb. But this does not enable her to believe in the resurrection. That comes a little later in our story. In the pre-dawn shadows, the empty tomb does not raise Mary's hope in the new life of the risen Christ. In the pre-dawn shadows, she sees it as nonsense, but it deepens her sadness over the death of her friend, Jesus. Now, even though the empty tomb does not strengthen her faith, it does increase her velocity. She picks up her heels and runs, sprinting away from the tomb to tell two of Jesus' disciples, Peter and the beloved disciple, how someone has taken away the body of their Lord and how the sad news about Jesus has gotten even sadder. Peer then into the shadows of Easter's first moment and see there a strange sight. Mary Magdalene in a breakneck dash away from the garden. As an old saying of the French Legion has it, when in doubt, gallop. But Mary is not the only one dashing about in the Easter story. When she gets to Peter and the beloved disciple, she no sooner gets her story out of her mouth than they too break out running. At first, they are both running toward something, running with amazement toward the source of their incredulity. Legs pumping, breathing hard, faces flushed, running toward the empty tomb, running toward the gaping hole in the universe of human expectation that is left by the absence of the body of Jesus. But gradually, John tells us, instead of simply running toward the tomb, they also begin to run against each other, turning their eyes away from the finish line and glancing enviously at one another. The adrenaline begins to kick in, and the mad and mutual dash turns into a foot race. These companions in sorrow become competitors on the track. Peter versus the other disciple, the pressure of the contest pushing their aching muscles to the limit as they rush along vying for God knows what. In fact, only God does truly know what they strive for in this mad dash. Why is everyone in this story running? At one level, of course, the answer is obvious. Mary and Peter and the beloved disciple would probably say that the reason why they have greeted this first Easter with instantaneous running is because of the fear and the excitement of it all, because they sensed intuitively that the moment was filled with electricity and dread and urgency. Like people who have been startled by a sudden sharp clap of thunder on a clear blue day, they did not immediately know exactly what had happened, but they spontaneously responded by jumping up and letting their feet fly. Whatever it meant that this tomb was astonishingly empty, It surely meant that they could not sit still, and so they ran. That, however, does not explain why Peter and the beloved disciples suddenly turned their jog into a race. If one pressed them a bit, they might sheepishly confess that they were running not only because they were excited and because they were awestruck, but also because they were, you might as well admit it, rivals. They started running out of exhilaration, but then competition between them took over and they wanted to beat each other to the tomb. All through John's gospel, Peter, the leader of the disciples, and the beloved disciple, the one who seems to be closest to the heart of Jesus, John himself, are natural rivals for center stage. When they heard Mary's word and began running, no doubt all that mattered to them initially was the news that the tomb was empty. But as they ran, the old rivalry clicked into place, and matching stride for stride, it began to count who got there first. Now, even this does not plumb the depths of their running. They may be running because they are excited, and they may be running because they are rivals, but the writer of John sees something much more profound in their foot race. John believes that these two disciples are not merely racing toward a vacant grave. Though they do not yet know it, they are running toward the future, toward the resurrection, toward a radical new way of life. When they started running, they were the pupils of a dead teacher. By the time their running is done, they will be the disciples of a risen and living Lord. So when John reports that the beloved disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first, he is not simply reporting the results of the heat. He's making a theological statement. John wants to say that the beloved disciple is the first person to arrive at Easter, the first person to believe in the good news of the resurrection, the first child of the kingdom to wake up and see the dawn of the new creation. Why is it important to know that the beloved disciple won the race? Why is John concerned to report that this disciple took a running jump and became the first human being to leap across the chasm between the old and dying age and the season of God's triumph? The reason is that the beloved disciple is first not only in foot speed, but first also in the way he came to believe. His way of believing in the resurrection, in John's point of view, the primary and essential way of believing. Others will come to believe, but not like the beloved disciple. Mary will believe when she actually sees the risen Christ and hears him call her name. The other disciples will believe when Jesus appears to them, saying, "Peace be with you." Even Thomas will come to believe when the risen Christ comes to him and offers to let him touch his hands at his side. But the beloved disciple is different. He believes when he sees nothing. He does not see Jesus. He does not touch Jesus. He does not hear Jesus call his name. He just peers into the empty tomb and believes. In other words, the beloved disciple, unlike the others, believes in the resurrection of Jesus in the light of Jesus' absence. He has no evidence save the emptiness. He has no proofs, no photographs, no scorched places on the earth caused by the burst of resurrection energy. He doesn't even really understand the biblical background of all this. All he has is an empty place where the body of the one who loved him used to be. But it is enough. John tells us he saw and believed. Now we can understand why, from John's point of view, it was so important to record who won that foot race to the tomb. John wants us to know that the very first believer in the resurrection, the forerunner of all Easter faith, came to believe in precisely the same way that you and I do, by not seeing the risen Jesus. The risen Jesus has not appeared to us in a garden and called our name. The risen Jesus has not found us where we were hiding and stretched out his wounded hands for us to touch. The Easter faith is not only he is risen, but also he is not here. The resurrection of Christ means the absence of Jesus of Nazareth, and the beloved disciple was the first to know that, the first to believe. Jesus said, "Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have come to believe." By this he means us, of course, and the beloved disciple who believed that he did not, even though he did not see, is our forerunner. Indeed, it is foolish, the foolishness of the gospel. Those who worship on this Easter day, who sing and say, "Jesus Christ is risen today," do so not because we have proved anything philosophically, not because we have discerned some mystical key to the scripture or found some unassailable piece of historical evidence. We believe in the resurrection because the beloved disciple, the forerunner of all Easter faith, believed and passed the word along all the way into the present, prompting frail folks like us to say what we believe. "I believe in Jesus Christ, who was born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead, and, dare we believe it, on the third day he rose again." Bill and Gloria Gaither were right on target when they wrote in their song, "Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone. Because I know he holds the future, and life is worth the living, just because he lives." Truly a word for us in today's world, and the glorious fact of the Easter resurrection. Let us pray. Gracious and loving God, we thank you today for that which we cannot understand, but which we appreciate and experience. Pour out upon us a renewed faith in your power and the peace that comes with hope in you and in the resurrection of Christ our Lord. Amen. Now we thank you so much for our special music. time of the offering, I would remind you that there are still several ways to give to the church, and if you're from a different church and visiting with us, to give to your church as well. We have an opportunity online. There's a PayPal button on our website. Certainly, this snail mail is available, and other ways you can go through your own banks, bill pay. There are ways to continue to support your church as we find our way together and navigate through this strange time. And so with gratitude for all that God has given to us, we gather our gifts together and we bless them as an offering to God. Let us pray.
We bring these offerings because of the love you have poured out on us in the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus.
Your gift calls for a response that cannot be tamed, animals or baskets. Nothing less than all we have and all we are is good enough to dedicate to your will and purposes. With fear and trembling, yet with joy, relief, and gratitude, we bring you all we have to give, ourselves. Use us that your reign may be realized among all people. Amen. Our closing hymn, Lift High the Cross.
Indeed.
Let us sing together. Hallelujah. It's our closing Easter farewell.